want to begin by bearing witness to a basic truth, that where we meet to speak of our children is holy ground. Whether it's in the street, or it's in this room, or it's in our homes, it's a sacred territory, and it's a sacred conversation. So I'm going to ask you to introduce yourselves in a different way until I do it formally, and follow my lead. My name is Asha Bandele. I'm the mother of Nisa Rashid. That's why I'm here.
My name is Marilee Odendahl. I'm the mother of Ian Murphy Machard.
Soy Javier Sicilia. Soy padre de Juan Francisco Sicilia. Y represento también a cinco muchachos que murieron junto con él.
I'm Gretchen Burns Bergman, and I'm the mother of two beautiful sons, Elon and Aaron.
My name is Joy Strickland, and I'm the mother of two beautiful sons, Charles Christopher Lewis, Chris Lewis, and John David Lewis.
Mi nombre es María Herrera Magdaleno. Soy michoacana. Estoy aquí con ustedes. Soy madre de ocho hijos. Cuatro de ellos desaparecidos desde hace 5 años, 5 meses, que no sé de ellos. Gracias.
Mi nombre es Teresa Carmona, soy la madre de Joaquín y también de Diego y Fabián.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Araceli Rodríguez. Y soy madre de 4 hijos, uno de ellos Luis Ángel León Rodríguez, desaparecido.
Good afternoon, I'm Karen Garrison. I'm the mother of 2 sons that were formerly incarcerated in their home now, but I still fight for the impacted family members.
These are the names of our children. We keep our children in the center. We put our children in the center and we put our arms around our babies. And our hearts are with our hands, whatever we're fortunate enough to have. Let's take a minute. Let's hold the space for our children. Thank you. Thank you. Let me do a little bit more formal of an introduction of this very esteemed and brave panel of parents who joins us today. Marilee Odendahl here, just beside me, is a writer, poet, and artist whose son, Ian, died from a heroin overdose in 2007. She works with the organizations Broken No More and GRASP. Please welcome her to the panel. Javier Sicilia has been transforming nations as the father of Juan Francisco Sicilia Ortega, been transforming certainly our movement here in the United States as the leader of the movement for peace with justice and dignity. He has done the hard, courageous work after losing his son in drug-related violence at Ground Zero in Mexico. Join me in welcoming Javier Sicilia. Gretchen Burns Bergman, I've worked with for 8 years. She's the executive director of A New Path, Parents for Addiction and Treatment and Healing, and also the leader of the Moms United campaign. Both of her children have struggled with addiction, gone in and out of prison. She was one of our leaders for what remains the largest sentencing reform this nation has ever known, Prop 36. Join me in welcoming this wounded healer. Friend Joy Strickland is from Texas and is the CEO of Mothers Against Teen Violence. Her own boy, she wrote a beautiful book called Joy in the Morning, about her beautiful son Christopher, who we lost in a drug-related violent act while he was about to attend college. Join me in welcoming Joy Strickland. Maria Elena Herrera is a widow and has 7 children. She's primarily worked in the gold business. In August of 2008, 2 of her sons disappeared in Guerrero, Mexico. In September of 2010, 2 more of her sons disappeared in Veracruz. Both of these instances occurred after her sons went through military checkpoints. Since then, Doña Marie continues to bring her case to the authorities to demand justice with dignity. Join me in welcoming her. Araceli Magdalena Rodriguez Nava is the mother of Luis Angel. She was a federal police officer who disappeared in November of 2009. She's been an activist and advocate ever since, has bravely spoken out against the drug war in Mexico, and is bringing her wisdom and her heart here to us. Please join me in welcoming her. Teresa Camarona's son was murdered August 7th, 2010, in prohibition-related violence. He was 21, talented, gorgeous, her firstborn, and he smoked cannabis, she says, and for that, he lost his life. We are here to reclaim his name and life. Join me in welcoming Teresa. And finally, Karen Garrison is with us today. She's the mother of Lawrence and Lamont, the proud mother of Lawrence and Lamont Garrison, who were incarcerated under mandatory minimum sentencing guidelines. For 14 years, she's worked to end the war on drugs. She's been a voice many of us are familiar with here. She co-hosts Mommy Activists and Sons, a radio show to assist prisoners and their families. Please join me in welcoming a spirit guide. This it's hard to begin to think about how one becomes an activist in the face of what is probably the worst pain one can go through. And it can't be an easy or a simple journey. And sometimes we see you speaking out and on panels, and we see your courage, but have no idea the work that it's taken to get here. I'd like to ask each of you to talk a little bit about the journey. It's not, I don't even know if it's a journey from grief to activism. I think the grief is always there, individually and collectively, for what we collectively lose when we don't, our children are not cared for. So if each of you, we can just go right down, would please answer that question and tell us a little bit about your own journey into activism.
First of all, can you hear me? I've had a lot of trouble during this conference hearing from the back. I want to speak to you as my son's mother. His name again is Ian. He was born on September 21st, 1979. And we lost him to a heroin overdose in Chicago on September 24, 2007, 3 days after his 28th birthday. So what's the journey from a victim to an advocate? To me, you're a victim when you have no more choices. My son was a victim of the war on drugs and of his drug of choice. It took me about a year to realize that although I am a damaged person for the rest of my life, I am not a victim. I don't really identify as a victim. I made a choice for life, and I identify as a mother, an activist, a wife, a pretty bad writer, and a pretty good gardener. All of us who have children like to tell everybody else how wonderful our children are And so I'll tell you a little bit about Ian. He was bright. He was funny. He was intelligent. He was a gigantic pain in the ass. He caused a lot of chaos in our family. And I caused a lot of chaos in his life through my own ignorance. It wasn't until years later that I realized there's an entirely different way to approach people who are addicted to drugs. And I think most of us in this room realize that that is with compassion and kindness and to never give up hope. When he was about 13 years old, he began to have social problems, anger problems. He was depressed. And eventually he tried to kill himself, and we put him in a mental hospital for about 4 months. And it was the worst decision we ever made in our lives. I think that his time there was so damaging to both him and us, and it was an endless round of diagnoses and treatment that didn't work. And eventually, when he was 16 and we lived in Albuquerque, New Mexico, he decided to leave home one night after a bad, bad argument with his father. And really, Ian never came home again until 4 months before he died. For a lot of that time, I didn't know if he were alive or if he were dead. I didn't know where he was. And he was basically on the streets. He traveled from one end of this country to the other and knew people all over. And he had a family of choice. And those were the people on the street with him. And although it's hard for us to understand, he found more comfort with those people and more understanding and support than he got in his own home, and certainly more than he ever got from his community. And society will tell us that a heroin user is a dangerous animal that you cannot trust, that can't be trusted to make a rational decision. And I'm here to tell you that that is not true. It is just simply not true. I had a psychiatrist tell Ian once, "Well, I understand why you do heroin. It's the best pain medicine in the world, and you are in pain." So was it a rational choice for Ian to decide to use heroin? I believe that it is. But unfortunately, that realization came too late. And my focus these days is to tell parents before they've lost their children to become educated, to become compassionate, not listening to those words, enabler, bad parent, what's wrong with your kid, and all the rest of the stuff that society tells us. He wasn't perfect. He certainly wasn't a saint. He committed nonviolent crimes. He sold himself for drugs. He was ashamed. He was stigmatized. But most of the time, was he an animal? No, he was an empathetic, intelligent, hysterically funny, very caring person. That's who he was. He just simply had an addiction. Sometimes he tried to get straight, and sometimes he embraced his usage. Sometimes he was broken and broken-hearted. In short, he was a whole, complex human being and a very good son in so many ways. His story of mental illness, homelessness, arrest, drug usage, death, it's tragic and it's so common. Excuse me, I made a few notes because my memory is so bad that I forget what I want to say. People talk about my loss, but I don't think that I've lost him exactly. I've lost his physical presence, but he is with me every day, every moment of every day. I heard a quote recently by a mother who lost her young, very young child to cancer. As she said, a life does not have to be long to be beautiful. And that went straight to my heart. I believe he had a beautiful life. He had a hard life, but it was his life. And coming to that realization that Ian's life is not mine is one of the things that helped me to move from a very deeply grieving parent, like we all are here, to being able to be an activist. And I thank many people who are at this conference today for helping me along that journey, because it's an arc. When you lose your child at first, you are immobilized with grief, physical and emotional grief. But over time, you can begin to make choices for your life again. And my journey really began listening to NPR and hearing Eliza Wheeler being interviewed, talking about Narcan, talking about clean syringes, talking about supporting people. And that is the first time, that was a year after Ian died, it's the first time I ever heard anybody say those words. And it was like a light bulb went on in my head. And I made it a point to contact her. And you know, when you hear somebody on the media, you think, oh, well, there's some highfalutin somebody or other. Well, I tell you, Eliza Wheeler is not that person. She was embracing, and here's how it went. From Eliza, she said, oh, you need to get in contact with Dan Bigg. He runs Chicago Recovery Reliance near where you live. So I went to Dan. Dan showed me the harm reduction van. He said, oh, you need to get in contact with Greg Scott. He's doing a piece for NPR about the drug trade in Chicago. So I met Greg. Greg says, oh, you need to meet Megan Ralston of DPA. Megan Ralston said, oh, you need to meet Grant Smith of DPA, who helped me to go to Washington to testify at the FDA hearing about naloxone over the counter, that question. At that meeting, I met Maya Doe Simpkins, who introduced me to Suzanne Carlberg Racich, and then to Alice Bell. And the point of all naming all these names is, first of all, I'm very grateful for them. But each one of those people was welcoming, was non-judgmental, and gave me something to do, which is the best cure for anything. And they're inclusive. In fact, everybody I've met in this movement has been inclusive and not exclusive. I'm not from academia, but nobody said that my voice was unimportant, that I could stand up and speak for my son. Eventually, I became aware of GRASP, which is grief recovery after a substance passing. And through GRASP, I met Denise Cullen. I met Barry Lesson. I got involved with Broken No More, our sister organization. So each person has given me something intangible that's hard to describe and very, very tangible in that here's a job you can do. So after that, it's up to me. How involved I want to be, how much I want to speak out, how many people I want to challenge. At the International Overdose Awareness Day event at Roosevelt University outside of Chicago last August, I was urged to give a call to action. And the whole message of what I said was to stand up, to speak out, and to get loud. This is not a movement about being careful about what you say or whose toes you're going to step on. So I would say, stand up, speak out, get loud, be heard, show up, donate your money to all of these causes in as much as you can. And finally, I do not despair. I refuse to despair. Ian informs my choices. He holds me to this life, which at first was a pretty tenuous thing. And he introduced me. I call all of these people the friends that Ian gave me. He may not be here, but he gave me all these wonderful people in replacement. And although they can't replace him, they come pretty darn close on a good day.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Buenas tardes. Gracias por la invitación, gracias por su presencia. Yo soy un poeta, es mi profesión, soy escritor, soy también periodista, pero siempre he creído que me formé con estas generaciones, sobre todo francesas, que hablaban del escritor comprometido, y siempre he tenido una participación en mi vida de escritor como activista. Creo que un escritor debe de dar testimonio en la vida, en su condición de ciudadano, por la dignidad. Y toda mi vida he participado en cuestiones activistas. Soy un fuerte aliado del movimiento zapatista en México. Así es que el activismo no me es ni mera antes del asesinato de mi hijo desconocido ni lejano, era parte de mi vida. Fui muy crítico y he sido desde antes del asesinato de esta guerra contra las drogas, muy crítico de los Estados Unidos, porque esta guerra nació aquí, no lo olviden, la decretó el presidente Nixon. Y se ha vuelto una política de Estado que está dañando gravemente no solo a los Estados Unidos, sino al mundo entero. Y México y Colombia son los rostros de Centroamérica más doloridos en sus víctimas por esta guerra, responsabilidad de Estados Unidos. Por esta guerra que además manda armas, vende armas. Es decir, tienen la política invertida, las drogas no es un asunto de seguridad nacional, es un asunto de salud pública, las armas son un asunto de seguridad nacional. Un adicto puede morir o no puede morir, si hubiera mejores leyes de protección, quizá morirían menos, pero las armas sí son de seguridad nacional, esas matan. Son contundentes, expansivas, asesinan o someten. Mi hijo es una víctima inocente de esta guerra. Mi hijo y sus amigos que murieron junto con él no eran adictos, no fumaban, eran deportistas, eran profesionales. Mi hijo estaba a punto de terminar su carrera de administración de empresas y trabajaba para una institución en el cuerpo administrativo, una institución médica. Esta guerra que compra Felipe Calderón y que ha continuado, por desgracia, la administración de Enrique Peña Nieto, exacerbó el crimen y a mi hijo lo, digamos, simplemente los secuestran junto con sus amigos y los asesinan por ir a reclamar un robo. Están muertos, no los mataron armas de fuego, pero los sometieron con armas de fuego y los asfixiaron con bolsas de plástico. Eso me los torturaron. Eso me llenó de una profunda indignación que se agregó a la indignación que ya traía contra esta estúpida política binacional. Nuestro gobierno es responsable de haber tomado esta guerra que ustedes inventaron, o su gobierno inventó, y la haberla implementado allá. Es responsable mi país de la corrupción que ha permitido todo esto. Yo salí con un grito que es difícil de traducir a otra lengua y con una carta donde responsabilizaba al Estado y a los criminales, me parecen la misma, unos legales y otros ilegales. Una palabra que es difícil de traducir que se llama "estamos hasta la madre", es decir, ya nos tocaron lo más sagrado. En ese momento empezaron a visibilizarse 40.000 víctimas de esta guerra, que habían sido no solo asesinadas, muchas de ellas, o desaparecidas, sino que habían sido criminalizadas por el Estado. Ser víctima en mi país era ser delincuente. Y salimos a pelearla y hemos caminado a lo largo de la República Mexicana abrazando y visibilizando a las víctimas. Y el año pasado atravesamos el territorio estadounidense y hemos vuelto para decirles que ustedes tienen una grave responsabilidad detrás de nuestros muertos por esta guerra, por esta prohibición de las drogas, por esta liberación de las armas. Y queremos caminar con ustedes y que caminen con nosotros para parar. Este es un asunto no de naciones, es un asunto humanitario, es un asunto de la gente, es un asunto de nuestras vidas. A nosotros, a ninguno de los que estamos aquí, nos va a devolver la vida a nadie. Tenemos a nuestros hijos muertos o desaparecidos, como en el caso de Doña Mari. Nadie nos los va a devolver. Esperemos que los hijos de Doña Mari sean devueltos vivos, sanos. Pero hemos salido porque no queremos que más padres vivan lo que nosotros estamos viviendo, porque no queremos que esta política de la violencia y de la prohibición esté llevándose cada vez más muchachos, tanto por falta de atención médica, tanto por falta de cuidado. Mueren inocentes o se los lleva el crimen organizado y los vuelve ejército de reserva de sus propios crímenes. Estamos perdiendo a nuestra juventud por esta estúpida política y eso hemos salido a luchar. Nuestros hijos son lo más sagrado, nadie nos los va a devolver. Uno, con esto termino. Ayer, hace poco decía Doña Mari en la intervención pasada en otro panel, que no hay nombre para los que perdemos un hijo, existen para los que pierden un esposo, una esposa, para los hijos que pierden unos padres, huérfanos, viudos, no existe para los que perdemos un hijo, es antinatural en todos los sentidos. ¿Cómo se siente uno? Voy a buscar una palabra, creo que hay una, por desgracia, que se ha usado muy mal para los vampiros. Se llama en francés revenant, en español revenido, alguien que viene de la muerte y la trae consigo. Y junto a su propia vida de todos los días, lleva también la vida de la muerte. Y es desde ahí donde sacamos nuestra fuerza, nuestro amor, para no sucumbir a ella y para dignificar a nuestros hijos a través de la lucha por la justicia que se les debe y para evitar hasta donde podamos y seguiremos haciéndolo que otros muchachos, otros hijos de otros padres tengan que padecer lo que nosotros hemos padecido. Muchas gracias.
And just thank Global Exchange and Javier Cecilia. It really, truly was a life-risking mission just to speak out for their children. And we are all here so edified by your presence and by your courage, your extraordinary courage. You teach us to be better parents. So I just wanted to thank you personally. Gretchen, my friend.
First, I have to share with you that I feel very overwhelmed, incredibly honored and blessed to be on this panel. This was a vision, a dream that I had, you know, in the middle 90s, that parents would actually start speaking up together about the injustices that we were experiencing. And at that time, people weren't talking about it. There was so much shame and stigma, as there still is, really. But then it was this deep, dark, dirty secret if you had kids who had addictive illness. My two sons are beautiful. They're bright. They have all kinds of promise. They're intelligent. But they do have this chronic illness of addiction. And in 1999, when I started A New Path, which stands for Parents for Addiction Treatment and Healing, I and some other parents had children who had addictive illness. And that can be really difficult enough just as it is. But when you also experience the shame, the discrimination, if you will, that's heaped on people, and the way that the criminal justice system mishandles this, and the roadblocks that they throw in the way of people having successful lives is so tremendous. That, you know, you asked, how do you go from being a victim to doing advocacy work? To me, I never had a choice. Yeah. I've been blessed to have very many roles in my life. I have a dance and theater background. I have a fashion show producer. I had wonderful parents, and I have wonderful sons, and I'm sisters, and all. I serve many roles, but the very, very most important role in my life is mother, and mother goes forever, no matter what, whether you lose a child or not. My two sons are survivors. They're survivors of the war on drugs. They're survivors of prison and the criminal justice system, and they're survivors of overdose. I am incredibly blessed. I still have hope. I have one son in long-term recovery now, the one that spent 11 years behind bars, or in the criminal justice system. It was really in and out. I mean, got picked up for marijuana and then comes out. Now he's using harder drugs, learned to inject heroin behind bars. It goes on and on. I couldn't help but speak out. I knew this was happening in other people's homes. I felt that in order not to be a victim, you must speak out. If my child had any other kind of disease or problem, I would be fiercely fighting for the best kind of services for them. So I never intended to learn so much about drug policy and addictive illness, but I did. And because I learned that, I felt it was my obligation to speak out and in so doing, enable other people to speak out so that we can change this huge, it's a human rights issue. It's a huge human rights issue. So we must all work together. And again, this is a blessing to have us all speaking out from different countries, different perspectives, different damages by the drug war. But parents who were marginalized, who have been marginalized, as if this was a bad parenting on your part, you know, we must shake off the shackles of shame and speak out. And so I see over the last several years changes. I see many, many more voices joining in this chorus for change. And we're making a beautiful sound, and we're making some changes.
That's right. That's right. And Gretchen has been at the center of this work and certainly has done so much over the last 8 years since I joined DPA and was running the grants program to to remind me to always be compassionate with my own daughter. So you have been teaching me as well. Thank you, Gretchen. Joy.
Thank you, Asha. This is a real privilege, and like Gretchen, it's overwhelming to be among parents who have experienced so much pain. It's really an overwhelming thing. My name is Joy Strickland. I'm the founder and CEO of Mothers Against Teen Violence. And my journey from victimization to advocacy, I guess, began when I lost my son. And he was, he didn't use drugs. He was doing all the right things. He had graduated from a premier college prep academy in Dallas, St. Mark's School of Texas. He was home from his first year at Morehouse College, and he was doing a friend a favor by dropping him off at a club when he and his friend were accosted by a 16 and 17-year-old, and they were looking for someone to carjack, and they were looking for money. So it was a totally random crime. And I think this tragedy turned my life upside down. I'm a former IBM marketing executive. I'm a graduate of UT Austin, and I was a math major. And I think it's because of my math background that I always felt that to solve a problem, you know, you have to be asking the right questions. You have to start with the right questions. And my first question was, how in the world am I going to heal my life from this? And I did manage to do that. And of course, healing doesn't mean that you're totally over it. You know, it doesn't mean that your life goes on as it did before. But it does mean that by God's grace, you can have you can still have a life, you can still have joy in your life, you can still have meaning and purpose, and I am so thankful for that. We began, as an organization, we began by offering services to other mothers and fathers who had lost their children. And shortly after that, we moved into violence prevention. Again, I'm always asking the question, the question now became, how can we end this scourge in our communities? How can we stop the violence? How can we stop what is happening to so many other families? How can we end that? And so I was listening to, when I heard the first speaker mention an NPR interview that she was listening to, and I was listening to NPR one day in my office, and I heard Judge James P. Gray talking about the war on drugs and his book, which is entitled How Our Drug Laws Have Failed Us and What You Can Do About It. And that was the first time in my life I'd ever heard the drug policy reform message. I didn't know anything about drugs. Drugs were not a part of my life. My sons, thank God, never used drugs, so I didn't know anything. But even though my son was killed by gang members, reputed gang members, I never made the connection between gang activity and the war on drugs. Mm-hmm. You know, I never made the connection between the turf wars and drug prohibition. I never made the connection between the war on drugs and so many of the intractable ills that are part of our communities. And when I heard this messaging, I felt it was incumbent upon me to lead my organization in rebranding itself to be about public information, education, and advocacy for drug policy reform. So, We made that transition, and fast forward this past year in the Texas legislature. Did I say that I was from Dallas, Texas? Yeah. Okay. This past year in the Texas legislature, we championed a harm reduction agenda. We championed a syringe exchange bill and a Good Samaritan bill. The syringe exchange bill made it all the way through the process. Can you hear me? Oh, okay, yeah. Okay. The syringe exchange bill made it all the way through the process and lost after a floor debate by one vote.
Wow.
The Good Samaritan Bill, which I authored, actually, submitted to my legislator, he filed, and it made it, again, all the way through the process, but did not actually get a debate because we ran out of time. That's the game that you play in the Texas legislature. You only have so many days. So we ran out of time. But we feel very good about where we are, and we, again, will be back in 2 years. The legislature meets every 2 years in Texas. So we'll be back in 2015, and we'll be stronger. We're building coalitions. We're holding strategy meetings. We held the first biennial Texas Drug Policy Conference in 2012. We will hold the second in January of 2014. And we're making tremendous progress. And I will close by saying that when you have this kind of experience, it carries with it a responsibility. And I think the first responsibility that you have as a victim is to heal your life, because you can't do an effective job from a position of grief and anger. Those are not affirming or evolving emotions. They're not transformational emotions. So you have to heal your life. And once you heal your life, then it's incumbent upon you to reach out to other individuals who've had similar experiences and help them understand that they can heal their lives. And then from there, if you're able and you feel up to it, then you have to work to change the system. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joy. Doña Mare.
Muy buenos días. Gracias por estar aquí escuchándonos. Veo que la compañera acaba de decir algo muy fuerte para nosotros. Ella dice, hay que sanar, hay que curar nuestro dolor, nuestra rabia, para poder ayudar a los demás. Pues la verdad, esto para nosotros es mucho, muy difícil. Quizás ella, por haber encontrado ya, pues digamos, una respuesta a su dolor, porque ella tuvo ya la gracia, la dicha de tener a su hijo, de sepultarlo, pero nosotras que no sabemos de nuestros hijos, es un dolor que persiste, es una rabia infinita, es algo que no podemos, es muy difícil sobrevivir con esta coraje, con esta rabia, con este dolor, y más sabiendo que el único culpable de todo esto es el Estado, porque nuestros gobiernos, muy lejos de cuidarnos, de protegernos, nos exponen, nos hacen más débiles, más frágiles, para que la delincuencia se aproveche de nuestros hijos, de nuestros seres queridos. Para nosotros esto es mucho, muy difícil, como les digo, porque no sabemos si nuestros hijos viven o ya están muertos. Es una búsqueda, digamos, en la oscuridad. Yo les voy a hacer este comentario. Durante 2 años, 4 meses, luché sola buscando a mis hijos. Bueno, no sola, porque mis hijos, mis cuatro hijos que me quedan, siempre me han acompañado, siempre han estado conmigo, haciéndome fuerte. Pero mi luz, mi esperanza fue cuando nació el Movimiento por la Paz, gracias a esta valentía de este gran hombre, de Javier, que a pesar de su dolor, a pesar de su coraje, tuvo la delicadeza, la gentileza de llamarnos, de invocar a las víctimas y reunirnos para alzar la voz. Por medio de él, en medio de su desgracia, en medio de su dolor, supo tener esa valentía, supo entregarnos su valor, infundirnos esa fuerza en medio de nuestro coraje, y aquí estamos. Gracias al surgimiento del Movimiento por la Paz, hemos alcanzado no la paz completa, porque no la tenemos hasta encontrar a nuestros seres queridos, pero sí nos hemos sentido hermanados, nos hemos sentido apapachados por Javier, por el movimiento, y gracias a él, gracias a esa sangre que derramó su hijo inocente, estamos aquí, muchísimas víctimas, nos hemos sentido, como les digo, protegidas, lo consideramos como nuestro papá, a pesar de ser nosotras más, por lo menos yo, más, mucho más vieja que él, yo lo considero como un papá, porque me siento protegida, me siento, como les digo, apapachada por el movimiento. Después de esta gran pérdida de mis hijos, yo me sentía como suspendida en el viento, no sabía qué hacer, hice todo lo que pude en la búsqueda de mis hijos, pero al cabo de 2 años, 4 meses, ya no teníamos recursos para seguir en esta búsqueda, ya habíamos agotado todo, y yo dije, bueno, ¿qué es lo que me queda ahorita ya? Ya no me puse a pensar en que tenía más hijos, yo lo que pensé fue en morir, dejarme morir, porque yo no recibía ninguna ayuda, consideraba que nadie me estaba ayudando. Es por esto que siempre le doy gracias a Dios por haber encontrado a este hombre con los brazos abiertos para ayudarnos, para protegernos, para ayudarnos a luchar, porque gracias a él estoy viva, luchando. Me preguntan, ¿desde cuándo te volviste activista? Créanmelo, no lo sentí, yo no supe cuándo llegué a este camino, porque desde el momento en que yo me presenté en el movimiento, empecé a conocer a las demás personas, a las demás madres que habían perdido a sus hijos, me sentí que era una sola, que esas personas desde el primer momento que me gritaron, no estás sola, no estás sola, me dieron su corazón, me tendieron su mano y aquí estamos. Mis 2 primeros hijos, Raúl de 19 años, Jesús Salvador de 24, desaparecieron en el estado de Guerrero en el 2010. El 28 de agosto. Desde ese instante empezó nuestra búsqueda, porque nosotros las madres presentimos cuando nuestros hijos están en riesgo. A mí nadie me quería creer que ese mismo día que mis hijos ya estaban siendo detenidos, mi corazón ya me estaba avisando y yo estaba sufriendo. Mis hijos me decían, espérate, mamá, pudieron haber sufrido algún percance, se descompuso la camioneta, o no sabemos, espérate. Pero yo les decía, no, ayúdenme a buscarlos, localícenlos. Es algo tan doloroso, tan cruel, que les repito, yo a la fecha no me he resignado a la pérdida de mis hijos. Sigo buscándolos con el mismo dolor, con el mismo ahínco, con las mismas fuerzas que los empecé a buscar desde el primer día. Gracias a Dios, les repito, mis hijos siempre me han acompañado. Y le doy gracias a Dios también y a Javier, que por medio de él nos ha hecho presentes y estamos aquí frente a ustedes, que ha sido una comunidad que nos ha escuchado, que nos ha atendido y que nos ha recibido. Porque desgraciadamente en nuestro país no hay leyes. No tenemos ahí nadie que nos ayude. Son 5 años, 5 meses y mis hijos no están conmigo. Espero que a partir de una fecha que nos acaba de dar el procurador, estén en la búsqueda de mis hijos. Yo espero encontrarlos con vida, espero encontrarlos vivos. Decía la señora, mi hijo fue un hijo maravilloso. Yo pienso que todos nuestros hijos son parte de nuestro corazón. Les dimos lo mejor de nosotras como madres y para nosotros todos nuestros hijos son maravillosos. Todos y cada uno tienen una vida propia, una historia. Y es algo que nadie podemos olvidar. Mi hijo Salvador tiene dos pequeños hijos maravillosos, unos niños lindos que no han podido disfrutar a su padre gracias a estas personas sin corazón, sin sentimientos que nos los han arrebatado. Mi hijo Raúl es soltero, pero lo extraño igual que a todos y cada uno de mis hijos. Como si esto fuera poco, en la búsqueda de mis dos primeros hijos, nuestra respuesta fue la pérdida de otros dos de mis hijos, Luis Armando y Gustavo. Ellos desaparecieron el 22 de septiembre del 2010. Ahora mi pregunta es, ¿hasta cuándo va a parar esto? ¿Cuándo vamos a alcanzar la paz? ¿Cuándo vamos a alcanzar la justicia? Cada uno de mis hijos son esposos, son padres de familia, todos tienen sus hijos. Esos hogares están llenos de tristeza, están en la oscuridad, porque lo he dicho siempre, a mis nietos les hace falta la figura de su padre, como en cualquier otro de los lugares, de los hogares donde falta el padre. No me explico cómo es posible que esté aquí ante ustedes, porque la verdad, hay momentos en que no siento fuerzas ni para levantarme, menos para luchar, pero sin embargo, aquí estoy, con lo poco que queda de mí, frente a ustedes, esperando despertar conciencias y que ustedes aquí en Estados Unidos nos ayuden, hagan algo, no sé, para poder encontrar a nuestros seres queridos. Ustedes como madres saben que la pérdida más grande, el dolor más grande para una madre es la pérdida de sus hijos. Yo perdí a mi padre, a mi madre, a mi esposo, pero todas estas pérdidas son pocas cuando se pierde un hijo. No hay nada que iguale este dolor. Yo sé que el motivo por el cual estamos aquí es otro, pero no podemos pasar desapercibidos. Necesitan de estar informados hasta dónde está llegando todo esto que se está propiciando aquí en Estados Unidos. Ayúdenos, por favor. Tengan piedad de nosotros. Esperamos de parte de ustedes un acto de misericordia. Ustedes con sus autoridades pueden hacerlo. Ayúdenos a encontrar a nuestros seres queridos. Gracias.
Just hold the space for a minute. We often hear things like this. And we just rush to the next. We're just going to hold the space a minute. We're going to hold the space. Araceli, you all right? Do you need a minute?
Bueno, pues Hay que tener mucha fuerza para poder hablar, porque hay veces que las palabras ya tampoco pueden salir de tanto dolor al escuchar la voz de María Herrera. Yo tengo a Luis Ángel, quizás asesinado, pero ella tiene 4 hijos. Y si para mí no hay vida, no entiendo cómo ella puede andar caminando. Pero bueno, la historia de Luis Ángel es no tan solo la de él, sino la de 7 policías federales y un civil desaparecidos el 16 de noviembre del 2009. Ellos fueron comisionados a Ciudad Hidalgo, Michoacán, a ocupar la Secretaría de Seguridad Pública Municipal. No les brindaron más que una arma larga de cargo y un oficio de comisión y que se fueran por sus propios medios. Hasta el día de hoy no me cabe en la cabeza cómo es posible que el Estado mexicano haya permitido que 7 de sus elementos salieran de una institución con gran renombre como era antes, la Secretaría de Seguridad Pública Federal, a cargo de el entonces ingeniero Genaro García Luna. No me cabe en la cabeza tanta negligencia. O sea, eran sus elementos los que iban a ocupar un municipio federal a servir y proteger a la ciudadanía. No iban ni de día de campo. Desde ese día hasta hoy, 8 familias en México estamos viviendo el dolor. Porque no hablo por Luis Ángel nada más. Hablo por esos otros 7 personas, 6 federales y un civil. Y me duele tanto saber que hasta el día de hoy hay 6 armas perdidas de ellos, que quizás estén matando más gente en mi país, porque ni siquiera ha hecho eso el gobierno, buscar esas armas entre todas las que ha decomisado el ejército a la defensa. Quiero decirles que para mí no sé si es más fácil aceptar que mi hijo está desaparecido, o saber por narrativa de los propios victimarios con los que yo me he entrevistado, porque así se lo he pedido a las autoridades bajo mi responsabilidad, entrevistarme con gente de la denominada familia michoacana, ahora Caballeros Templarios, aunque yo sé que para mí mi vida está en peligro. Pero para mí es más miedo no saber la verdad histórica de qué pasó con Luis Ángel, a tener miedo y quedarme sentada y callada. El 3 de febrero del 2010 supe por voz de altos mandos de la Policía Federal de Fuerzas Federales de Contel Iztapalapa en México que mi hijo, sus compañeros y el civil estaban asesinados, pero que jamás íbamos a tener cuerpos, que a ellos los habían balaceado, los habían descuartizado con motosierras y los habían incinerado. Y pues estaban muertos, pero no iba a haber cuerpos más, porque a ellos los habían lanzado a un puente en Michoacán. Cuando las familias escuchamos eso en un salón tan grande como este, algunos desmayaron, otros no soportaron y se infartaron. Yo salí del salón corriendo y gritándole a Dios que porque se había tapado los ojos o vendado, ¿no? Porque se había volteado y no había visto lo que le estaban haciendo a sus hijos, porque lo había permitido. Y le juré a Dios que si él no había podido detener este horror, que Luis Ángel y sus compañeros y el civil no iban a quedar impunes, que no sabía yo cómo le iba a hacer, pero que iba a hacer retumbar su nombre en todo el mundo de esos 7 policías federales y el civil, porque no era justo que quedaran impunes si eran seres que se habían dedicado a proteger y servir a la ciudadanía. Y más me llenaba de impotencia porque fui madre y padre de mis 4 hijos. Desde chiquitos trabajé para sacarlos adelante, inculcándoles principios y valores. Y no se me hacía ético que la propia institución, el propio Estado, me estuviera desapareciendo a Luis Ángel. Es por eso que emprendí mi lucha, de principio sola, con otras periodísticas que anunciaban que se habían encontrado en alguna laguna los cuerpos de los 7 federales y el civil, y siempre poniéndole el nombre de mi hijo Luis Ángel León Rodríguez y el de sus compañeros. Y todo era falso, era para ver si las familias caíamos, recogíamos esos cuerpos y ya no hacíamos nada. Cuando a mí me dijeron que ya no hiciera nada porque mi familia estaba en peligro, Cuando me llegó la primera amenaza de muerte diciéndome que advertían secuestros narcocriminales, yo no me podía quedar callada. Y no podía hacerlo porque no era ético de mi parte también caer en el pantano de la porquería del gobierno. Me quité el miedo y di pasos enfrente. Cuando recibí la foto de Luis Ángel y de sus compañeros, a donde antes de ejecutarlos los habían retratado, ellos estaban, mi hijo estaba como atado a un árbol y con sus ojos enormes, llenos de terror, viendo que en ese momento lo iban a ejecutar. Yo tengo esas fotos y para mí, de verdad, créanme, que he aprendido a sobrevivir buscando desde mi interior la paz. Porque si yo me quedo con la última foto que veo de mi hijo un día antes de salir de la casa, sonriendo y con la familia, y veo la foto donde lo tienen los criminales, o me muero o me vuelvo loca. Es insoportable. Pero quiero decirles que a pesar de que nos quisieron entregar alguna vez, el 19 de diciembre del 2009, 8 cuerpos que estaban calcinados en San Juan del Río Querétaro, las familias luchamos para que nos hicieran pruebas de ADN. Gracias a Dios, no eran ellos. Seguía la esperanza de encontrarlos vivos. Pero después las autoridades nos hablaron diciéndonos que uno de los cuerpos era positivo al comandante Pedro Alberto. Volvimos a ir las 8 familias a exigir que no recogiera a su esposa el cuerpo y efectivamente tampoco era nuestro. O sea, de todas maneras nos querían entregar algo que no era nuestro. Teniendo a distancia peritos de la Policía Federal diciéndonos no recojan el cuerpo, no es suyo. Y teniendo a unos metros una carroza de la misma Policía Federal queriéndonos entregar el cuerpo. O sea, Dios, ¿dónde estaba la coordinación de la misma institución? Por un lado nos decían no lo recojan y por el otro ya teníamos a la carroza. De verdad, créanme, hemos vivido, no nada más yo, todas las víctimas de México, momentos muy difíciles. Y soy el eco de su voz de todas las víctimas de mi país. Cuando encontré el Movimiento por la Paz con Justicia y Dignidad, cuando vi por primera vez a Javier en la televisión llorando y narrando lo de su hijo, inmediatamente las lágrimas escurrieron de mis ojos. Dije, ¿qué está pasando? ¿Cómo como seres humanos nos estamos destruyendo los unos a los otros? O sea, ya no podemos seguir así. No supe en qué momento llegué al Movimiento por la Paz. Y gracias al Movimiento por la Paz, a las organizaciones que se han unido a nosotros, a los chicos de políticas de drogas, a Sara, y a TED, a muchas organizaciones, a Sam, a Laura Carcel, yo hice posible realidad lo que le había prometido a Luis, poder hacer retumbar su nombre en todo el mundo. Y yo ahora a mi hijo lo veo en cada rostro de ustedes, porque Luis Ángel está aquí, sus compañeros están aquí, y están aquí porque son mi energía para seguir adelante. Y las amenazas, créanme que a mí no me intimidan. A mí me da más miedo callar que seguir luchando por la justicia de mi país. Y lo voy a seguir haciendo mientras que yo viva. Porque ni la amenaza que me hizo directa Genaro García Luna y que me dijo que pensara 10 minutos cómo me gustaría morir, ni esa amenaza me intimidó porque aquí estoy ahora sentada con ustedes. Quiero decirles que tengo 3 hijos más, 2 hombres y una mujer. Uno de mis hijos, Giovanni, es policía federal, también activo en la misma institución de su hermano. Y por él lucho, y lucho por todos los policías de mi país, que no los protegen, no los cuidan, y los que están activos ni siquiera los tienen trabajando dignamente. Y no voy a parar, mi voz no calla, mi voz no calla, mi voz seguirá hasta que el día que Dios quiera y decida llamarme, Pero por mí seguiré de pie y de frente. Y juntos seguiremos hasta la victoria. Gracias.
Teresa?
Yes. I was planning on speaking English. So I will just say a few words in English, then I will switch to Spanish because this is overwhelming. First of all, thank you for being here. And thank you for staying here. A lot of people have left the room, and we understand that. There is too much pain to be contained in this room, and not everybody is up to it, so thank you. I wish the legislators we just had a conversation with after the previous panel they participated in, some Mexican legislators, we had a gathering with them in private, very intense, very moving. Some compromises were made there, but I do not see their faces here. So I am sorry for that. Nos preguntan cómo pasamos del activismo, del dolor al activismo. Pasamos al activismo en el dolor. El dolor es nuestro combustible. Y esperamos llegar a la paz. Este dolor cambia cada día, como todo cambia, pero será nuestro combustible. En mi caso, yo tampoco me di cuenta cómo pasé al activismo. Un día el poeta dijo, ¿quiénes me acompañan? ¿Quiénes están sintiendo lo mismo que yo? Y yo estaba sintiendo lo mismo que él. Joaquín, mi hermoso primogénito, fue asesinado 8 meses antes que Juan Francisco. Y ese día que Javier convocó a la sociedad civil agraviada y dolida, yo salí a la calle de mi ciudad con una fotografía improvisada de mi hijo. Y supongo que ese día me convertí en activista. Y lo hice porque no podía hacer otra cosa. Porque tenemos que encontrarle un sentido a este duelo y a esta vida y a este horror. Porque tenemos que ponernos en los zapatos de ustedes, así como ustedes se ponen en los nuestros. Y tenemos que entender que cualquiera es vulnerable, que todos podrían estar en el lugar que estamos nosotros. Entonces, por eso es que caminamos juntos. Gracias de nada, porque siempre es estar dando y recibiendo. Es irónico que venimos a hablar con nuestros legisladores en los Estados Unidos. En México nos ha costado más trabajo. Pues les hablaré un poco de Joaquín, me gusta mucho hablar de Joaquín. Era inquieto, era tremendo, también me dio dolores de cabeza, me salieron canas verdes, ahora están blancas, pero las primeras fueron verdes. Era brillante también, era fantástico, se comía el mundo de un bocado. No le alcanzaban las horas del día para hacer todo lo que quería hacer. Estudiaba, hacía deportes, echaba desmadre con sus amigos, conquistaba niñas, dibujaba, le gustaba mucho el mar. Joaquín nació en Cancún y desde los 13, 14 años descubrió el boogie board. Entonces él me decía que se iba al mar a meditar, a esperar la próxima ola. Paso muchas horas ahí. Yo quisiera poder llevar las cenizas de Joaquín al mar. No lo he podido hacer porque hay una investigación abierta. Desgraciadamente esa investigación no avanza porque creo que no le importa a nadie en la fiscalía. Está el expediente guardado en un cajón. Pero espero poder hacerlo. Darle una despedida en grande con música y con amigos. Con sus hermanos y su padre. Pero también le quiero agradecer aquí a Javier, frente a ustedes, por ese valor que nos ha sabido. Hemos podido reconocer ese mismo valor dentro de nosotras mismas y eso ha sido muy, muy grande, porque efectivamente sin esa conciencia de que somos fuertes y valientes, posiblemente ya nos hubiéramos vuelto locas. También nos ha enseñado a caminar juntos, a reconocer lo que podemos hacer. Empujamos una ley general de víctimas. Hemos tenido un papel importante en cuanto a visibilizar no nada más el tema de la guerra contra las drogas. En esta conferencia aprendí un término que creo que todos ustedes tendrían también que conocer. Hablamos de crimen organizado y aquí ayer nos decían que no es exactamente crimen organizado, es crimen autorizado. Entonces, creo que tenemos mucho trabajo, tenemos que aprender a hablar, tenemos que aprender a sentir. Tenemos que aprender a sentirnos cómodos con el sufrimiento, con el dolor de los otros, a entender que si abrimos el corazón y abrazamos ese dolor, pueden suceder cosas grandes y muy luminosas. Y creo que es una linda manera de celebrar la vida de nuestros hijos muertos o desaparecidos. Ustedes viven en un país que yo personalmente tenía muy satanizado. Sin embargo, a partir de la caravana que hicimos el año pasado y ahora de este encuentro tan importante, que con tanta gente de diferentes rincones, los veo de otra manera. Los veo como personas iguales a nosotros, que a veces no hacen un gran esfuerzo para aprender español, pero al final de cuentas están aquí escuchándonos y eso para nosotros es muy importante. Thank you. Muchas gracias y recuerden que la guerra contra las drogas es responsabilidad de todos.
As we are about to hear from our final speaker, you know, it was hard for me to think about how this discussion would go, because it is hard to sit in the face of so much pain, but harder, of course, to live in it. And often in these sessions, we have time to have discussion with the audience, but I'm realizing the importance sometimes of just listening to people when your own legislators won't. And not everybody can stay in the room. It's interesting that you said that, Teresa. I was having a conversation with Jim Gollin right before I came to this panel, and he was telling me about your meeting with legislators, and I said, you know, everybody can't sit in the face of that. Everybody can't sit there. You have to learn how to do it. Unfortunately, we usually learn it in the face of horror. But so I do want to thank you all for having the courage in the heart to sit and listen and to hold the space for our incredible speakers. And with that, Karen, I'm just going to offer you the final word of the afternoon in these last 10 minutes that we have together.
Thank you very much, and I'm so pleased to be here, and I realize how important it is for us all to come together, and you see a parent's pain. You know, my pain is nothing compared to the losses that they've suffered. And I remember when Gretchen told me about the Caravan for Peace coming through the United States, I tracked it every day, every city. I even at the end, when they got to Baltimore, and I went to Baltimore and D.C., my show, when we highlighted the end, I had a lady, I think her name was Marta, she called in and translated it in Spanish. So I made sure that everyone got the idea of what happened and knew the events that happened. But my thing is the criminal justice system, the injustice that my sons faced. They were sentenced to 15 and a half and 19 and a half years for a cocaine conspiracy where they knew no one in the conspiracy but one guy. And he had my mother's car in the car, you know, getting her car repaired. And when he got arrested, he put my sons in it. And they took they had no drugs, no guns. They even tested them at arrest for drugs in their system. They had nothing. But they went to jail anyway. You know, the short part of it is that we live in D.C. They took it to D.C. wouldn't take it. Maryland wouldn't take it. Virginia, the Commonwealth, it hasn't changed a bit, said take them. And they took my sons to jail. I watched them go. But what's, you know, it's like, you know, I never was really mad. You know, I was hurt because they were just physically not there. I saw the end come. They haven't had closure, and they don't see the end. You know, and I think all the time about how it's not luck. It's the way God chose it, but it hurts just the same. But it's God's plan, but it makes you strong because so many other people need you to do what you do. You know, you represent so many people. Even though you had the buses come there, when I saw so many people in Baltimore, was unbelievable. And the church, they slept on the floor, you know, and they went to wash their clothes. Nobody was like mad because they had to do what they did, but they did what they did coming all the way across country just to ask for our country to help them. But when my sons went to jail and came home, I knew that there were things that I had to do in between that time. You're talking about a mommy becoming an activist. Well, I was a cosmetologist. And I made a joke in my speaking. I said, well, everybody got a PhD. I have a PhD, professional hair designer, because that's what I was. I had all the papers and everything you needed, esthetician. I could make the oils. I could tell you every chemical that was in anything that I used. I had no clients lose their hair because of me. So, you know, these things were good, and they hurt, but you heal and you get over it. But what I tell everybody to remember, you treat everyone the same. These are all our people. These are all our children. You have to embrace the issues. And so I knew that God had ordered some steps for me. My son came home in 2008, and I found out about a free radio show you could do. And he and I used to do it called Coming Home. It was on my way home then, simply because it was so much I thought I had covered and got him ready to come home. He was a twin. He came home. A baby came home first. And it was so many things he didn't have covered that we thought we did, so we decided to share it. And the radio show began to roll on and on. Until now, I'm doing it, and I have a pretty good listening base. I make sure that my thing is to be able to give everybody the information, because I didn't know nothing about this. As they call it, hood rat. I knew all about my neighborhood when it was beautiful. Then they changed it to something ugly called hood. But I'm living right there not knowing everything. But the radio station I know helped me to get information, helped me to give information, so that we all could, as citizens, go to these politicians that we elected in and be able to deal with them in a responsible way. And that's my theme, to make a difference in a responsible way and to cover issues in criminal justice system, the human rights and civil rights issues. And, you know, because I know my steps were ordered, I see it every day. I know that it was time for me to do things outside of my job because they didn't do enough. There was more to it. And knowing that it's more to this drug war than just crack cocaine. But one thing I'm going to do, I'm going to show how my steps were ordered and how things come
together. When I first started out, it was Steve Silverman. After I was on the news, he told me, he said, no, don't you sit there. These people want to see you. I said, see me do what? I don't know them. He said, oh, they see you. They watch the news. Go stand by somebody you knew. I went and stood by Eric Sterling that I saw because he was on the news at the same time. And from then on, they start talking. Then I knew how to move and work the crowd, you know? And those things were very important to learn. And I know that without Dorothy Gaines on my radio show, she's one that we pump it together. Mm-hmm. You know, I decided after a while to do something because I felt that Dorothy was never, ever given her full credit. And so I decided to do a project, which I have many, but one I stuck with, to call her a reunification specialist, to do consulting. And she does just that. From the beginning, when you get your papers and you're indicted, she takes the family and embraces the whole issue, as well as ones in prison. You know, but in between there, I met Nkechi Taifa. Everybody knows that name. She helped me to make sure that I kept on track, that knowing that it's not fair, it's not working, when we did the media, the resource kit, which was very important, still very important. And getting online and attending other activities, I met Andrea James, that's in the audience, with her daughter, that's an author, as well as she has an organization, Healing for Justice, or Justice for Healing, I'm sorry. And also Regina Kelly from American Violet. Her story was the one from American Violet. These are people that helped me put it together, helped me track it every day. And my newfound friends, we went to dinner, and Manuel told me, don't forget when you go down there to speak that how good you are and you're in charge. So now that's what I'm remembering last from him that I learned. So my steps are always ordered, and my radio show is to make a difference in a responsible way, and I feel that I keep pumping it up for that reason, because if anything, you can get on your cell phone or you can get online and you can get this information, and that's why I'm here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen. This is an incredible moment, the first time I heard you speak with your sons, and let me acknowledge Daniel Ribello, who did so much to ensure that that caravan traveled throughout the states. He slept on floors. When I first sat down with Global Exchange, they said, can we just have a small grant to do a little administrative work in the beginning? I said, oh, okay. Well, this just be a little thing. We didn't know it would transform our organization, become our focus for that entire summer practically, and we're so grateful that it did, and so grateful you took that work up, Daniel. And you know, I wanna say something too about hope. You know, I started doing this work, focusing on this work when I was still an editor at Essence Magazine, and one of the first stories that I did was I edited a story on Dorothy Gaines, who was given 19 years and 7 months for a drug crime that she did not do. And I will tell you that I sat around the table of black women, and they said, so what? They said, so what? I had to fight for that story. You don't know that. You didn't know that. I had to fight for that story. And it did run in Essence, and we were able to ask readers to please sign in. Essence has the largest penetration into the black women's market. 8 million people read it every month. And Dorothy did come home shortly after that article. But I tell you this, nobody would say, so what now? Because people have had the courage to raise their voices, to challenge this war on drugs, to say it matters. Every life has value. Every life matters. They've had courage and walked through the blood of their children to be here. And I want you to join me in thanking this incredible panel of people who came from so far away to be with us. Over the course of the next day, please take time to ensure that our guests from other countries are made to feel welcome here, to start looking at what are some of the policies that we need to change and be active on so no more children go missing, no more children are found dead, and no more children are put in prison because they have an addiction. That's our job, and that's our call. Thank you.
Perdón, si me permiten un minutito de su atención. Quería decirles algo. Nosotras, todas las víctimas, en nuestro caminar, encontramos más y más víctimas necesitadas de apoyo, de ayuda. Muchas víctimas no saben cómo llegar hacia las autoridades. Como nosotras ya tenemos un camino recorrido, buscamos la forma, la manera de ayudarlas, pero hay algo que se interpone en nuestro camino, los recursos. Hay ocasiones que nos llaman y no tenemos los recursos para acudir a su llamado. Esto lo ponemos también en sus manos, en su corazón, porque es aquí, de parte de ustedes, de donde hemos recibido el mayor apoyo para lograr hacer lo que nosotros podemos o queremos hacer allá en nuestro México. Gracias por escucharnos, gracias por estar aquí con nosotros y esperemos que no nos olviden y que sigan echándonos la mano para lo que estamos buscando, ¿no? La paz, la justicia y a nuestros seres queridos. Gracias.